for sometimes not transforming. But one of the things somebody told me once is there's a lot of good reasons, but no good excuses. And so maybe we've got some good reasons, but we've got to get rid of the excuses. Brother Les Brown, who's a motivational speaker that many of you know, I used to listen to him a lot because he was so profound. He was a good motivational speaker, but he was also very profound. And one of the things that he said, you know, the question often came to him, when will things get better? With all the immorality, with all the crime, with all the violence, with all the bullying, with all the belligerence in our communities, and not just black communities, but communities all over, he said, when will things get better? And his answer to that question is, things will get better when we get better. Things will get better when we get better. We're always looking outside ourselves, but honestly, our candle has got to burn brighter. I think that's what this transformation is about. So in other words, things will get better when we get better. They'll get better when we transform. So that's the message of this show. And I think oftentimes we're out there doing a lot of things, but if we're not transforming at the same time we're doing what we're doing, are we really doing this the community a service? And so another way that I like to put it, it's about being and doing. Being and doing. We have to discipline ourselves to develop on the inside so we've got something to offer on the outside. We've got to discipline ourselves to develop those internal qualities on the inside so we have something to offer on the outside. And when I'm talking about internal qualities, I'm talking about qualities of faith, of kindness, of justice, of compassion, of honesty, truthfulness and sacrifice and forgiveness and love. And we develop these qualities, and Brother Selvin knows this, we develop these qualities in the fire of our service to the community, by disciplining ourselves to demonstrate these qualities while we're in that fire. Then we see heaven in our faces, and then we can see that potential in others. So again, it's about being and doing. And transformation, when we talk about transformation, you know, the bar is high. But I think transformation works this way. It's a little bit, little by little, day by day process, simply trying to do the next right thing in the moment and continually asking ourselves a question as we go about our daily life, as we interact in the communities, as we struggle with other human beings. The question we want to ask ourselves is always ask ourselves, what is the next right noble thing to do in this situation? What is the next right noble thing to do in this situation? And that can make us pause in the heat of the moment if we ask ourselves that question. What qualities do I need to draw on in this situation to create the best possible outcome? And I think life is full of moments to create opportunities to grow. But again, friends, that growth, as we all know, will happen in the fire. My religious faith happens to be the Baha'i faith, and there's a passage in the Baha'i scripture that says, "Busy not thyself with this world, for with fire we test the gold, and with gold we test our servants." Let me try that again. "Busy not thyself with this world, for with fire we test the gold, and with gold we test our servants." So that's it. That's what this show is about. It's about transformation. It's about being. It's about doing. It's about seeing heaven in every face. So I'm going to bring our guest in here right now. I'm not going to give him the full introduction right now, but I told him that everybody on this show, I want to talk about what heaven means to them, seeing heaven in every face, what that means to them. And so I'm going to just introduce Selvin Waldron, the executive director of Life Pieces to Masterpieces, very briefly. I'm going to give him a full, respectful introduction in just a little while. But I just want to ask you, Selvin, and first of all, I want to say welcome. I'm so glad you're here. I know you're busy. The work you're doing is so profound, and I can't wait to get to that. But I want to ask you, what does it mean to see heaven in the face of black men or black women or black boys or black girls? If you were seeing heaven in every black face, what is it you'd be seeing?
Well, let me first thank you, Brother Ratta, for having me here today. It's a pleasure to be here on your show. When I hear seeing heaven in the face of black men, it reminds me of freedom first.
Mm.
Especially now with Sister Harriet Tubman being placed on a currency soon.
Mm-hmm.
It really reminds me of what possibly that feeling could have been pre-freedom for many of our brothers when they may have crossed that river, crossed that bridge, hit through that forest, and then were welcomed by friendly faces that then became their freedom.
Right.
That must have felt like heaven.
Absolutely.
And that's the feeling that I get when I hear heaven in the face of black men. I see heaven in us daily.
I know you do, brother.
I see it in us daily. I grew up in a place where you really had to trust your neighbors, trust your surroundings, trust your just everything. Mm. And when I moved to the U.S., you really had to sort of transfer that trust as well.
Yeah.
So I see heaven in us every single day.
Yeah. Praise God. Yeah. I do too, brother. And you know, the thing, part of why I'm saying we need to see heaven in every face is because sometimes it's hard to see that in every face. Sometimes we look and we see that facade, we see that hardness, you know, we see that exterior that isn't always behaving and showing that heaven, but we know it's there. I think we always got to believe that it's there. You know, there's an expression that says, look at a person the way they are, they only become worse, and look at them the way they could be, and they become what they should be. And I think that's not always the case. But I think it gives him the best possibility, and I'm going to tell a story a little bit later. I'm sure you've got a lot of stories from your work about this. But when I think of heaven, I looked up the definition of heaven. But I always like to do that because it just adds some insight to it. But heaven for me is partly a feeling. But it says heaven is conceived of as domains of divine beings in various religions. Powerful, right?
Wow.
And then a second definition is a place or state of supreme happiness, expanding a place of beauty, paradise, contentment, and ecstasy. So that's what heaven is, and that's what I see. And you know, I gotta say this to you, right now, because Salvin, because sometimes things make me laugh. I read this book a while back called "Reclaiming Our Black and Hispanic Students" by Crystal Kirkendall, and she had this brother that she talked about, and this is about seeing heaven in people's face when it's hard. This brother was a guy they used to call Lion Lewis because he lied all the time, right? I told this story last week, but it's a true story. And with all due respect to the lawyers out there, Crystal Kirkendall said, she was a teacher, she said, I used to see heaven in his, she didn't say I used to see heaven in his face, she said I saw the good, the potential in his face, right? And she said, so she always talked to him, she always encouraged him. She said, you know, Lion Lewis, you could be a lawyer. You'd make a great lawyer, right? Now, again, all due respect to the lawyers out there. But guess what? She saw something in him. That's the point. You know, somebody could easily look past that, look at him and say, look at what he is. He'll never become anything. But this brother became a lawyer because somebody saw heaven in his face and that potential.
Absolutely.
I'm going to talk a little bit about transformation, the kind of transformation that I'm talking about in this show, and then we're going to pull you in and talk to you more about the organization you run. I didn't want to mention it yet, but I will, because that's going to be the heart of the show. When we talk about transformation means a thorough or dramatic change. And I was reading something that Dr. Alain Locke, a philosopher, educator, he was the first Black Rhodes Scholar. He was known as the Dean of the Harlem Renaissance, also a member of the Baha'i Faith, the religion I belong to. He said something that was very profound, but just something about Alain Locke, because everybody doesn't know who he is. Here's what Dr. King said about Alain Locke. He said, we're going to let our children know that the only philosophers that lived were not Plato and Aristotle, but W.E.B. Du Bois and Alain Locke came through this universe. Yeah. W.E.B. Du Bois and Alain Locke came through this universe. So that's the stature that Alain Locke had. But here's what he said about what I consider transformation. He said, we must begin working out the new era courageously, but it must be a revolution, he said, within the soul. It must be a revolution within the soul.
Yeah.
And so last week, you know, I always think about how do we get these concepts across effectively. And you know, as you know, with your organization, the arts is an effective tool. Right. But Langston Hughes wrote a poem. And this poem sets the bar very high. And I just want to read this, and then we'll move into talking about Life Pieces to Masterpieces, the organization that you're the executive director of. The poem that he wrote, it was called I Too Sing America. I've read the poem for years, but one day I sat down and I read, you know, sometimes things hit you,
read
them, and then eventually, right? And sometimes you read them year after year, and it really strikes a chord. So, we're going to have to take a break in a minute. So let me do this so I can get to you for this next part of the show, for the entire part of the show. It said, I Too Sing America. I'm the darker brother. They send me to eat in the kitchen when company comes. But I laugh and I eat well and I grow strong. Tomorrow I'll be at the table when company comes. Nobody will dare say to me, eat in the kitchen. Then besides, they'll see how beautiful I am and be ashamed. I too am America. So brothers and sisters and Salvin, the reason I bring that poem up is says when he went to the kitchen, it says he laughed. But I don't think it was the kind of laugh that was ha-ha. I think it was the kind of laugh that said, okay, I got this. Yeah. I got this. Yeah. And he said, I eat well, and I grew strong. And then what happened? He makes a statement of fact. He says, tomorrow I'll be at the table, and company comes, and no one will dare tell me to eat in the kitchen. Besides, they'll see how beautiful I am, and they'll be ashamed. I, too, am America. So here's the point of it. What did he do in the kitchen that made him so powerful? That's the question that I asked myself this time when I read the poem. And what I think he did, you know, and again, He said, I'll be at the table tomorrow. So something he did in that kitchen that made him so powerful, so strong, that he knew there would be no doubt that he would be at the table tomorrow. And I commend you, or I submit to you, that he transformed himself to such a degree that when he walked out of that kitchen, no one would dare say that you have to go back in that kitchen. So he ate well, he grew strong. I submit to you that he transformed himself. So Brother Selvin, with that, I want to give you a proper introduction and ask you some questions. I've got your bio here. Brother Selvin Malcolm Waldron is the Executive Director of Life Pieces to Masterpieces. He's recognized by the College Board with the 2014 Dr. Asa G. Hilliard Model of Excellence Award, in 2005 the Ozzie Davis Award for Spirited Arts Activism. And there's a little bit more here about Life Pieces to Masterpieces, but I'm going to let him talk about that part. Brother Selvin joined Life Pieces to Masterpieces in 2012 as a Director of Development and Grants and immediately began to implement the organization's three-year resource development plan. Now, after I read this, everybody's going to want to hire the brother, so leave him at Life Pieces to Masterpieces. But Brother Selvin, under his leadership, he solidified its organizational sustainability, and check this out, he increased its revenue by 22%. Okay, the phone's going to ring off the hook, brother. He diversified its funding streams and strengthened its financial procedures, allowing the organization to both grow its programs locally and spread its impact nationally. And then just a couple other awards. He was a member of the 2013 cohort of Leadership Greater Washington Effective Leadership Institute, the 2014 Leadership Sanctuary, and he currently sits on the advisory board of the University of the District of Columbia of Business and Public Administration. Last awards, and these may not be the last ones, but in 2015 he was awarded the Honorable Ron H. Brown Distinguished Leadership Award, and in 2016 he was a recipient of Amtrak's Monumental Pioneer Award for Community and Youth Activism. It's my pleasure to welcome my friend, Selvin Malcolm Waldron, to the
show. Thanks for having me, Todd.
Yeah, we got to give him a shout out. That's a lot of stuff.
Thank you for having me. Whose bio was that?
Yeah, that was you, my brother. That was you. I want to ask you, and I think we're going to have to go to a break in just a minute, and a very short break, because I really want to give you the time that you need to explain the Life Pieces to Masterpieces. But I think we're going to go in about 2 minutes. Why don't you share just a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Well, first, thanks for having me, Todd. This is a pleasure to be here in your show. I grew up on a very small island, Trinidad and Tobago.
I grew up
in Tobago, the smaller of the two. 80,000 people population, so very small. Everyone knows each other there. My dad was in the fire service. My mom was in the banking industry. I just grew up just wanting to be in service. I grew up with Nelson Mandela being just that beacon of hope, that life, that central spiritual shared humanity type to bring different cultures together. That was sort of my beacon growing up.
Yeah,
I also grew up with just knowing I wanted to be in a place to serve.
Yeah.
So my upbringing, my high school years, my college years, even now, has always been about service. I have a passion for just being in the community, being amongst youths, working in education. For me, education was a passport to my future. Mm-hmm. And I want to be able to reach back, lean back, go back, and just share that, leave that with the youth that are now coming up in the program.
Powerful. And I've seen it firsthand, brother. I've seen that spirit of service. I could say more about Brother Selvin, but I want to give him the time to explain a little bit about the name of the organization, and maybe a little bit about the founding of the organization to start off with.
Yeah, so it's a mouthful. Life Pieces to Masterpieces.
Yes.
Life Pieces to Masterpieces. When you hear that name, it's just a lot to unpack out of it.
Right.
Really, we all begin life as a blank canvas, Todd. We don't pick our religion, we don't pick our race, we don't pick our, you know, sexuality, our gender. We just arrive here.
Right.
A blank canvas. Mm-hmm. And through life, over time, our experiences, our challenges, you can call that the paint.
Right.
You know, our successes, you can call that the stitching.
Hmm.
Our trials, you can call that just, you know, what makes us who we are.
Right.
But you flip that blank canvas around, and on the front of that blank canvas, whatever pieces I use, whether it's paint, whether it's stitching, whether it's, you know, acrylic, that is indeed a masterpiece.
Yeah.
on the front side.
Oh, wow.
And that metaphor is really what is in the life pieces to masterpieces. Mm-hmm. And for us, the youth, the young men that we serve are the masterpieces.
Yeah.
Their lives are this kaleidoscope of success and challenge and trial and triumph.
Mm-hmm.
And on the surface, they are doubted. And Heaven Face a Black Man just comes to mind. Right. On the surface, they are doubted, but within their spirit, they have overcome so much. It takes tremendous courage to maneuver the neighborhoods that many of our young men maneuver every single day. Yeah. It takes courage, Todd, to just get up and go every single day.
Exactly.
You don't know what you're going to encounter.
Right.
So Life Pieces for 20 years has been that sort of oasis, has been that, you know, freedom.
Right.
For over 2,000 plus African-American boys and young men.
And say that again. How many?
Over 2,000 boys and young men have come through this program, have been touched, have been transformed, and have gone on to jobs, gone on to teach, gone on to become artists, gone on to just transform their lives and their communities.
You know, one of the things that impressed me right away, I didn't say this, but I met Brother Selvin walking down the street. He was getting off the bus or a cab or whatever, and he was walking down the street in front of the house, and he just had that kind of dynamic look. And I had to just stop him and say, you know, where are you going, brother? He said, well, I'm working down here. Then he told me about the program, and I thought, oh, man, I got to see this program. But anyway, I want to, again, drill down just a little bit more about it. You serve what age? This is what's... mind-blowing, the age range that you serve.
That's one of the unique part of the program. We serve ages 3 to 25. That's a very wide age group. And that's what makes our program very unique, Todd. It's a very longitudinal model.
Yeah.
Between ages 3 and 13, it's our after-school program. That's a daily program where it's art, it's social-emotional skills development, it's exposure trip, it's mentoring, it's black male identity.
Right.
It's character development.
Right.
Every single day, where we surround these beautiful, brilliant young men, ages 3 to 13, with loving staff and mentors who have their absolute success in mind.
Right.
Every single day, from 3:15 until 7 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
We work with about 14 different elementary, middle schools in the Ward 7, Ward 8 area of Washington, D.C.
Right.
They come to our site daily.
Yeah.
So the viewers are probably, listeners probably asking, so what happens when they get to age 14?
Right.
We transfer them into our Saturday Academy program. Right. It's college time now. We prepare these young men for college. Right. So on Saturdays, of course, for 4 hours, you were out there last Saturday, Todd.
Yeah.
These young men are getting ready for college. Mm-hmm. So it's financial aid skills. It's college 101, how to study, how to submit homework, testing skills, SAT skills. We drill down even deeper on what it is to be a black man in this world.
That's right.
You know, for 10 months, they go through this program from ages 17 every year until ages 70.
Mm.
They stay in this program where we surround them again with more mentors. Right. Now at this age, we're surrounding them with professional mentors, folks in professions like engineering and nonprofit leadership and biology and college professors. Surrounding them with these mentors to really angle them towards their college success or their career success.
Right.
So that's 14 to 17.
Mm-hmm.
Your listeners are probably asking, what happens at age 17?
Exactly.
So at age 18, we have the Education Architect Program.
Right.
The Ed Architect Program. This is a model that started off of a need, and that's the thing, the innovation. Need is the father, the mother of innovation. We were realizing that in our school system, there was a lack of black male present.
Okay.
There were no heaven in the faces.
Right.
You know, in the school system there.
Exactly.
And many of our youth, you ask them how many black male teachers you have, they'll tell you zero.
Right.
They may tell you one if you're lucky.
Right.
But at Life Pieces, for years, we had this, you know, ambiance of just beautiful black men leading educators, leading classrooms.
Right.
So we wondered to ourselves, are we in a bubble?
Right.
So we launched the Ed Architect program to shake up this conversation that black men do not want to be educators.
Right.
We started training black males in D.C. From the neighborhood, from the community, over an 8-month period where they go through classroom management techniques, classroom leadership.
Right.
How to work with youth to opt out of learning.
Sure.
Probably cultural opting out of learning. You know, professional skills, dressing for success, interviewing skills. And then we also, in the last 2 months, Todd, they get 16 hours of testing prep to become certified power professionals.
Wow.
Then we place them in the schools, public schools in D.C.
That's powerful.
And that's our model. It's just 3 to 25. You have an after school with social emotional.
Right.
You have a Saturday academy with college prep.
Right.
And an education architect, professional development, shaking up the conversation of black men in the education workforce. That's our model.
I mean, you can't beat that. You can't beat that. It's so powerful. And I've seen it firsthand. Again, I'm not going to say anything because I want you to have the floor. But you know, I've been to the academy, the Saturday Academy, most of the time. I've also gone to the after-school program, I think the 11 to 14 or whatever, right, that age group. I've been there several times. But mostly the Saturday Academy. And I also went to the volunteer training.
You did.
And one of the things I was impressed with is, and I wanted you to talk about, is some of the premises. I don't know if that's for all the programs, but for that program, one of the premises says love plus security plus expression equals life.
Equals life. That's the central component of all our programs. At Life Pieces, you can go to any program and really feel that you're in a Life Pieces program.
Right.
So what you just mentioned is our premise, which is a central component of the Life Pieces Human Development System. That's
right.
Our curriculum.
Right.
This is a curriculum that was awarded the Asa G. Hilliard Award for Model of Excellence.
Okay.
It's recognized by various organizations. It's just a curriculum that is able to unpack, expose, awaken human beings, really,
right,
to their innate brilliance.
Right.
So the premise tells us the environment that's needed.
Mm-hmm.
What is the environment that we must provide to ensure that youth are ready for learning?
Yeah.
That environment is one of love.
Right.
What is love? Love is both language. Love is the atmosphere.
Mm-hmm.
Love is the words we say.
That's right.
Love is how we stoop to talk to the youngest of them.
That's right.
Love is listening.
Mm-hmm.
You know, security,
mm-hmm,
is that safe environment,
right,
that the young people and people in general feel as though their words are respected.
That's right.
Young people feel as though they're being listened to.
Mm-hmm.
And expression comes in various forms, whether it's visual through the artwork,
right,
whether it's, you know, through percussion on the drum, whether it's through performance when they create these elaborate plays in the summertime, whether it's them doing homework,
right,
that's them expressing themselves.
Exactly.
But when it's the three-year-old tying a shoelace and saying, "Brother Selvin, I can tie my shoelace,"
right,
now, that's expression.
Exactly.
So that's the component, the equation for the environment that leads towards life.
Right.
Love, security, and expression equals life.
Yes.
And that life is just the awakening.
Yeah. And on the sheet of paper that I saw, it had those crossed out and,
yes,
saying when that's not there.
When that's not present. No love plus no expression plus no, it's death.
It's death.
It's
exactly.
Death.
It's death. And, you know, it's interesting because, and you know, I wish we had time to actually walk the audience through one of the exercises we went through on Saturday, but they probably wouldn't get it across the airwaves. But just the fact that they really needed to express themselves in a certain way,
right,
and they had to stand up with a certain confidence to say what it is that they needed,
right,
to say. And there was, they were lovingly called on it. If they didn't, not in a chastising, mm-hmm, way, but in a way that says, we got to step up a little bit,
right,
more if we're going to go out in this world and really be effective. And then you have another part of the what you call your process, which again has deep meaning for the program. And all this is about the human development of our young people. It's about connect, it's about create, it's about contribute, and it's about celebrate. And can you talk just a little bit about that?
Absolutely.
Because again, those are profound.
That's our 4C process. It's a process that's used in the artwork creation.
Right.
It's a process that's used in, you know, how do we connect with the youth? How do they connect with us? So as you said correctly, connect is that first stage.
Right.
Before we can begin math, reading, arithmetic, homework, you have to make that relationship bridge.
Right.
Because the young people are looking for first a relationship. They're looking to really find out, will you be here tomorrow?
Right.
If I came back here, will you be here still? Or could I do something and then you say, I'm gone?
Yeah.
So first we have to connect with the right. youth, and they connect with us.
Right.
Then you have to create. And really for us, creating is just owning the imagination.
Right.
Dreaming. You know, you can create anything. Mm. At every second, millisecond of the day, we are creating. We're creating thought. We are creating friendship. We are creating relationships.
Right.
We contribute, which is really sharing.
Right.
We want to ensure that our curriculum, our young people are sharing all that they learn here
right.
in our program with the broader community.
Mm-hmm.
And then we celebrate.
Yes.
You know, the body energy.
Right, body energy, right.
You celebrate. Celebration is important.
Yeah, it is.
Particularly when you read books like The Miseducation of the Negro.
Right.
You know, when you go to many public school systems, our black male youths, our brown male youths sit to the back of the class.
Right.
They are afraid to raise their hand when called on. They may not raise their hand at all.
Mm.
So for us, we celebrate.
Yeah.
Celebrate any response at a very early age.
Sure.
When the youngest is, you know, shy to just raise that hand up,
right.
we celebrate them.
Right.
We body energy. We give a lion's roar so right. that they know this is a touchdown.
Right.
To raise the hand proudly,
right.
confidently,
mm-hmm.
and we'll celebrate your response.
Yeah.
And it's a circular process. So then that person must then circular, right. do it all over again.
Amen. You know, Sam, we got to take a short break. But when we come back, I really want to talk about the themes on this button, and I know people will be able to see that, and but there's some deep substance of what's on that shield.
Yeah.
Actually it's a shield. So let's take a short break and come back, and let's talk about the meaning of that shield for these boys.
elifemedia.net or call Reg Gaskins at 240-832-4455. We have a mobile app for Android and iPhone, and on the net at TuneIn Radio. eLife Media is radio, video, and television, the ultimate media broadcast network. Listen to us on the web, download our app, or watch us on YouTube. eLife Media, the ultimate media outlet, broadcasting live radio and TV worldwide, powered by live music for you.
You're listening to eLife Media, the ultimate media outlet, broadcasting live radio and TV worldwide, powered by live music for you.
You're listening to eLife Media, the ultimate media outlet, broadcasting live radio and TV worldwide, powered by live music for you.
You're listening to eLife Media, the ultimate media outlet, broadcasting live radio and TV worldwide, powered by live music for you.
It's the good life. It's your life. It's my life. It's eLife Media, powered by live music for you.
In your lifetime, do you think you or anyone you know will shop online at a name brand retailer, purchase a movie ticket, go to the gym, take a vacation, want to make more money? How about want to learn how to improve their credit or get out of debt? Did you reach your goals in 2015 or on track to reach your 2016 goals? Would an extra $250 or more a month help you pay off a bill, add to your savings, or pay school tuition? For those questions and the answers to those questions, contact Nove. Nove is a lifestyle enhancement company. Our members enhance people's lives in four key areas: financially, socially, mentally, and physically. Earn significant income by sharing our lifestyle membership concepts with others. Want more information? Just watch our short video at www.novelife.com. That's NOVAELIFE.com. Or contact Pat Smith at 202-500-9848. 40. If nothing changes, nothing changes.
On with the questions about really how you drill down with these kids and the premises that you operate under, the processes you operate under, and you have this shield, which is your what you call your decision-making tool, and it's in the shape of an octagon, and we're both wearing them, and I hope the cameras can pick them up. But talk about that shield, will you, Selvin, because it means so much to the program.
Absolutely. I mean, Life Pieces is just such a well-done model.
Right.
It's simplistic, yet it's so deep.
Right.
And the shield of fate, as we call it, is that core. When you come to Life Pieces, our site, and I know the listeners can't really see the visuals, but if you were to come to our program site, mm-hmm. we have a snapshot of our curriculum. And you'll see the pieces there. You'll see the purpose. Mm-hmm. You'll see the premise. You'll see the process. And in the center of that human being, that figure mm-hmm. that stands on our curriculum, in the center and the core of it is the shield of faith.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really what it is. It's right. The core of
right.
the program.
Right.
And on the shield there, it looks like a color wheel, so you can visualize a color wheel with the addition of black and brown.
Mm-hmm.
So we added those additional colors. So there are eight colors. And with those colors, we have placed values. Values that in our program's 20 years, we know these values are important for the development, and I should say the positive development of human beings.
Right.
And let's start first with the color red.
Mm-hmm.
Red on the shield of faith is spiritual principles.
Mm-hmm.
And just like a color wheel, colors complement each other.
Right.
So red complements green, which is meditation.
Right.
And then there's orange, which is loving, which complements blue, which is giving.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's yellow for language, which complements purple for art.
Yeah.
So those are six colors so
right.
far.
Right.
And as with any color wheel, when you mix those six colors together, you'll probably get a brown, muddy color.
Mm-hmm.
That color is discipline.
Mm.
And again, it's a lot of metaphors. We're mm. artists by nature.
Yes.
And if we're saying when you mix those six colors together, you get a brown color, which is discipline, really, in essence, if you were to be able to balance those values,
right.
if you were a master of those values, if you were disciplined in using those values,
right.
that's,
right.
in essence, where discipline comes from. And if we were to do more mixing again, we had a big paint bucket and just
right.
mixed all those colors in some more,
right.
added in the brown and mixed them some more, you'll probably get a black color.
Yeah.
And that black color now, she's shield of faith, is leadership.
Right.
And that's the metaphor again.
Yeah.
If, as leaders, if we're able to balance all those values
yeah.
and be disciplined in using those values,
right.
you'll be a leader.
Yeah.
And we picked black very intentionally.
Right.
Because very often, in the U.S. and around the world, black has been associated with a negative connotation.
Absolutely.
You know, Black Friday, you know, blackballed,
right.
blackmailed.
Right.
We wanted to associate black with a positive
exactly.
value.
Exactly.
And for us, black is the value of leadership.
Right.
And these colors are used in our art process as well. When our young men are creating our very unique Life Pieces art style, they're using these colors. Where
mm-hmm.
colors are placed,
right.
as you went through the project on Saturday, they have meaning.
Exactly.
So where the young men place colors in their artwork, if they're doing an art piece about, you know, a sailing trip or about bullying or about kite flying or about
mm.
some domestic situation,
right.
where they place colors goes back to the shield.
Right.
So it's very therapeutic. It's
right.
very, very emotional. It's very revealing as to all their experiences.
It's reinforcing.
It's reinforcing.
Yeah.
And it's a safe space instead of where, you know, you can go and tell someone I'm experiencing this. The art is a safe space.
Right.
And the values provide communication
right.
of all the experiences that you're going
yeah.
go, going through.
Exactly.
So that's the shield of faith. It's the core of the program. It stands very firm in the center.
And they may get that at home or in church, but in a sense, they don't get this in this kind of combination where they get it reinforced in real life situations, practical activities that reinforce them. They learn the language of using those qualities. They learn to talk about what they mean in their lives. I mean, I've seen it, and it's an amazing thing to see.
It's a good safe space. Instead of asking someone, what are you going through? You ask them in the artwork, so why did you pick green to explain that?
Right.
And then they'll tell you, I picked green because it's meditation, because I feel at peace when,
Exactly.
It's really a safe space.
Yeah. It's practical application.
Absolutely.
You know, most programs for young people, or many programs for young people that I've seen, they don't have the spirituality component, and they don't have the meditation component. Yeah. I mean, really, they don't have the loving component, and many don't have the arts component, but, we could go on. But I think the ones I've seen, I'm not saying none of them do. Yeah. I don't want to criticize any programs out there. But the bottom line is, How do you integrate the concept of spirituality for young people? How do they grasp that? And maybe what it means to you and how they grasp that.
Well, whenever we explain the Shield of Faith, we always start with spiritual principles. Right. It's red. For us, spiritual principles is respecting everyone's God of higher, God of their understanding.
Right.
Whatever spirituality of your understanding you have, respect that.
Exactly.
So we expose them to various types of religions, various types of spiritual practices, whether it's Judaism, whether it's Islam, whether it's Baha'i, whether it's Christianity. We expose them to all of it.
Right.
So they understand why do groups follow these types of faith.
Yeah.
And for spirituality really begins with self.
That's right.
It's self-thought.
Yeah.
It's, for me personally, spirituality is meditation.
Yeah.
It's me just thinking about this life and being thankful for it.
Right. Right.
Being thankful that the universe placed me here and placed me with a frame of mind to want to reach back and give back and push forward.
Right.
I'm thankful.
Yeah.
So it's a combination of meditation and thoughts and just thanks.
Yeah. Being thankful kind of lifts your energy, lifts your spirit. There's many challenges in our life, but to maintain a level of thankfulness, I mean, again, it takes us to another place. You know, there's a lot of questions I could ask, but I want to find out, how do young people find out about your program? Where do you draw the boys from? Again, it's black boys. It's ages 3 to 25. Where do you draw these kids from? How do they become a part of your program?
Many of our young men hear about us from word of mouth.
Okay.
Being in the Ward 7 community now for going on 20 years, we have a reputation there as a model that is that extra arm, that extra support for the family.
Right.
So many of our youth hear about us, whether it's from the mom, the dad, the aunt, the school, the principal, the counselor, the teacher. They hear about us from their older brother, their younger brother, from the cousin, and they show up. They fill out our enrollment form. And our program leadership, Elder Bill and Aunt Lo and Brother Mo, meet with them.
Yeah.
Meet with that young person, with their parent, and talk to them about the program.
Sure.
And find out whether or not they're really interested.
Right.
And then they join.
Right.
We have an 88% retention rate. So our youth stay with us really their entire lives. There's one young man I'll talk about. Brother Alex.
Okay.
Alex started in our program at age 7.
Hmm.
He's now 23 years old.
Wow.
He has gone through our after school. He has gone through our Saturday Academy program. He worked with us as a junior mentor, then a senior mentor, then as a lead teacher. He went to college at Prince George's Community College and then to the University of District of Columbia.
Right.
And then he joined our Ed Architect program last. It was in the first group that extended into an 8-month training. And Alex is now a teacher's aide at Dr. Charles R. Drew Elementary School.
That's great.
With a family, a full-time job, and committed to being an educator.
Yeah.
He has a dream of starting daycare centers in the future.
Beautiful.
And it all started when he was 6 years old in the program.
Yeah.
It's people like that Life Pieces work you know, it's absolutely amazing experience.
Yeah, yeah.
There are brothers like Brother Andre, who is now in a master's program at Virginia Commonwealth University, also started at about 6 years old.
Right.
Grew up in the program, now is a young man in the, doing his master's.
Mm.
We have another young man, Brother Tyreek, who is out in Wisconsin University.
Mm.
Yeah. These are the brilliant stories about the program.
Yeah. And it's been around for 20 years, which is really, it's amazing. I want to see if anybody wants to call in and ask you any questions. We've got a few minutes left, but I want to invite anybody to call in to share or ask questions about anything that we've talked about in the show. But I want to, because this is such a unique program, you know, for so many reasons, to think about, you know, the future of the program.
Yeah.
Where is Life Pieces to Masterpieces going? Is it expanding? Yeah. Or what direction is it going to take from here?
Yeah, so something you said earlier really gave me chill bumps, Todd. You read that poem.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they sent me to eat in the kitchen when company comes.
Right.
We have a painting at Life Pieces called America, What About the Children?
Mm.
America, What About the Children? For centuries, hundreds of years, black men, black people have been in the kitchens of America.
Yeah, that's true.
We have been the people building the railroads, the people building the monuments for years. So for 20 years, Todd, black boys and young men have come through this program and they have gone on to do amazing things with their lives. So this year in October, on October 5th, at the Pepco Edison Place Gallery in Chinatown, Northwest Washington, D.C. We will celebrate 20 years of impact and outcome. 20 years where, for the last 10 years, we've had 100% graduation rate for our Saturday Academy program.
That's amazing.
Where 93% of the youth in our after school are reading at or above level. Where 97% of the youth in our after school are either increased or maintained their grade in math.
Amen.
Where we have a 90% pass rate of the young men in the Ed Architect program taking the power professional examination. We are going to celebrate.
Yeah.
We want to celebrate the young men who have to maneuver their neighborhood to go to school and show up on time of the day. We'll celebrate the young men who are told they won't make it anywhere in life,
right,
but are making it even further than they ever dreamed of.
That's right.
We'll celebrate all that this year. We'll celebrate the artwork, 20 years of artwork.
Mm-hmm.
We'll celebrate 20 years of impact to Washington, D.C. So October 5th, 2016, Pepco Edison Place Gallery, we will present to the district, the nation, and the world why indeed Life Pieces belongs here and where we indeed to expand and grow.
You know, you mentioned the art pieces, you know, and I don't know if the listeners grasp the beauty of those art pieces and the fact that I understand you actually sell these art pieces.
We do, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they're that quality that people buy. And it's not just chump change, you know. these are pieces of work, so it's not just like...
They're beautiful pieces.
Yeah, it's not like they're just, you know, buying their time just doing something, playing in paint.
Absolutely.
They're actually creating something that has meaning.
Masterpieces,
and they are masterpieces. So the number to call, I believe, is 240. Help me out here. 240-455-5934 if you have any questions for our guest, Selvin Malcolm Waldron from Trinidad, Tobago.
Yes, sir.
And I'm hoping people were able to listen and actually picked up on the show, because I believe they would be calling in with questions. You know, I was reading a passage, and we're going to have to wind up here fairly quickly. But well, let me just ask you if there's anything else you want to add about Life Pieces to Masterpieces, and I'll close with this short passage about children. But anything else you want to share?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot on the horizon for us. Again, this is our 20th anniversary year. I want to definitely echo the sentiments of some of the most amazing, hardworking staff, youth advocates for the development of our young men that we have attracted. We've been able to attract a shared humanity team, a very diverse team of professionals, young people, mid-age people, to just come to this mission and just give their 120% every single day.
Oh, yeah.
So I can't do this work without that amazing team, Todd.
Yeah, I know.
I'm here on the radio and they're back doing the work.
Right.
every single day. Yeah. So we have an amazing team at Life Pieces.
Absolutely. Is there a call? Okay, we've got a call. Just got a few minutes left. Please. Can you hear me? Go ahead with your question or your comment. Apparently they're not hearing me for some reason. Are you there, caller? Okay, something must be amiss here. For whatever reason, it's not coming through. Can you hear me? Okay, so I guess apparently we won't have the caller this week. Just got another minute or two. I don't know if you want to try to call back, caller. Well, while we're waiting for the caller, I want to, and I don't want to jump ahead too far, but we are just about out of time. But I want to mention who our guest is next week as we close down. I know who our guest is, but I want to say the name of the gallery the way that it needs to be said. Our guest next week is Weiss and West. He is the founder and owner of Serengeti Gallery and Cultural Institute, and it's right up the street on Central Avenue. Again, it's an amazing art gallery. They also do work with young people, but have probably one of those beautiful collections of art. Okay, so we've got a caller. Are you there, caller? Please share what you would like to share. We've just got a few minutes. Can you hear me?
Hello?
Hello?
Yes, hi. Am I on the air?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Well, first of all, I just want to say congratulations to Brother Sylvan, I believe.
Sylvan, yeah, Sylvan.
Yes, for the program, and I mean, it's just a wonderful sounding program. I think it's just amazing, and I just want to say congratulations for all of the work that he's done. And that the institution there has done for its students who have passed through. It's a wonderful blessing. I'm a teaching artist myself, and I work with inner-city youth, and I know how important the arts are. I was wondering if there are any plans to sort of branch out and have other models in other areas where it's also so very needed. And also, if there are any plans to have a school like this for our girls as well.
I'm sure you've had that question, huh,
yes,
Sylvan?
Great question. I didn't catch the name, though.
I'm sorry, I really can't hear because the music is really loud. So I think I'll hang up and then just let you answer that.
No.
Continued success.
Are you still there?
God bless. Thank you.
The music is muted.
The music is now muted. Thank you for that amazing...
Oh, I can hear now.
You can hear it now. Thanks for that amazing question. Didn't grab the name, but I definitely thank you for your service as a teaching artist. Life Pieces is so committed to Washington, D.C. We know that we have this vision that what could really happen if in every single school in Washington, D.C., there was a Life Pieces program in the school. What kind of transformation could that bring to the D.C. school system? So the first place of commitment for us is in Washington, D.C. We want to saturate the Washington, D.C. school system, place ed architects in every single school possible, train teachers, have art, train artists in the schools, in all schools in D.C. So that's really our first line of attack, for lack of a better word. For our girls, when we started about 20 years ago, there were programs that was actually working with girls. And we started with seven boys originally who were living in the Lincoln Heights community. And those seven young boys, six of them were without their dads.
Hmm.
Jump forward to 20 years later, and it's still one of the needs that the parents come to us with. They want a safe space. They want a space where their young men, where their sons could be amongst other men. They want a space where their sons could see heaven, see examples in the community.
You know, I hate to do this album. We've only got probably about 10 seconds left. I hate to cut it off because I know that's an important question.
Yeah.
This is my, actually, this is my sister-in-law, Nancy, calling from, from New York.
From New York. Thank you so much, Nancy.
From New York,
Thank you, Nancy,
thank
for
you,
calling.
Brother,
and Brother Salvin, thank you so much for coming. Executive Director of Life Pieces, the Masterpieces. You got the idea of the program. Again, look it up if you want to enroll your child in one of the programs. I want to say next week again, Weissen West of Serengeti's Art Gallery will be here. Meanwhile, remember to see heaven in every black face and transform ourselves, transform our communities, claim your nobility. Thank you very much, and I look forward to seeing you next week at 6 o'clock.